I'm here with John Kanellopoulos. John, the ASCRS clinical survey of membership, showed what's to me, I guess, a little bit frightening news, which is that the estimation by the membership was that for glaucoma medication, only 24% of patients are actually compliant. Does that number shock you? Does it surprise you?
It does, and thank you for asking the question, Josh. It does shock me. We all know as clinicians that compliance is not at the level that we'd like it to be. In my patient population, I had estimated, I guess, thinking positively, that it would be around 70%. But 25% is really astounding, and I think it makes a strong statement, thank you, Ascaris, for putting this study together, towards what and how we treat glaucoma patients.
Now, John, let's say that you've a patient coming in and the pressures are controlled or within a point or two of your goal. How do you, first of all, what raises a flag for you that a patient may not be compliant? And then how do you assess whether the patient is? Because as you know, you can't ask the patient if he's compliant because they're going to say yes.
Right. Well, you bring up a very good point. In my glaucoma fellowship at Mass Eye and Ear, we were taught and we learned that using eye drops for the eye doctor is like flossing for the dentist. So usually patients are very compliant around their visit. I usually become very worried if I measure in my office good intraocular pressures within the target that we have set and nevertheless see on visual field or optic nerve examination or OCT measurements of the optic nerve and ganglion cell layer that there's a deterioration, then you have to think that this patient may not be compliant. We also have to consider that the majority of glaucoma patients are elderly patients. Some have kinetic problems, some have reading problems, some have just arthritis, they cannot use their medication easily, they're forgetful. So there's a milieu of factors that we have to consider in this very sensitive treatment, because we know that their well-being relies on them using the medication. And this is not a small population. We're talking about 2.5 million Americans, and we expect them, unfortunately, to be about 5 million in 15 years.
Now, in my practice, if I put a patient on a medication and the patient comes in and the pressure was the same or similar to the unmedicated pressure and the patient insists that he's compliant, one of the things that I do is I'll go to my sample closet, I'll get a bottle of tears, I'll say, I don't want to put you on the spot, but would you mind showing me how you put in drops? And of course, a lot of them, I discovered, then need training because they're sticking the bottle in the eye and squeezing right. You to know what the dose is. What are some of the other things that you do in the context of your practice as tools to sort of help your patients with compliance?
Well, I think one has really to evaluate how does the patient experience the drops as far as comfort. A lot of times patients do not use the drops because they're just uncomfortable.
Oh, so they sting, yeah.
They sting, they burn. Some of the drops we know may add on a chronic allergic conjunctivitis, so they don't like their eyes feeling itchy and red. Also, the frequency of drops. If I have to choose between a medication that's used once a day or one that's been used three times a day, obviously the choice is on using the one once a day. Compliance will be far better. And I also like to group medications towards combination drugs that are used less times a day, thus to enhance medication. I also like to learn from the patient what is their standard daily ritual. Some people among us are better in using things in the morning because they tend to do more things in the morning that are on schedule, take other medications, shave, comb their hair, whatever. Others are better at bedtime. So that is very crucial in tailoring the treatment, not towards necessarily what the industry or our knowledge says, but towards what individual patient needs are.
Yeah, and you know, that's a great point, that the data ultimately comes from sort of population-based studies, and that even though the patient is an N of one, he's not really a representative measure of any population, it's an individual patient. One of the things that you just mentioned now is that to encourage compliance, that you try to steer patients towards medications that either are used less frequently or that correspond better with the schedule that the patient has. In this same rubric, where do combination medications fit?
Well, I think it's very convenient for the patients, but we cannot ignore the issue of cost. A lot of these patients, as we mentioned, are usually retired. They are not using just glaucoma medications. Most of them are out-of-pocket, and I think that one has to put all these factors. If the patient can afford the treatment, if the patient can afford the treatment long-term, a lot of people worry about their eye pressure. Once the good eye pressure has been established, then you may lose those patients from compliance. So it's something that you have to work day in, day out. So I like to see them at least four times a year, and I like to every time have them speak to my clinical coordinator and try and establish the fact that compliance is not an issue. Fortunately, a lot of my patients come in with family, and I think that's important to speak with family members and see if they're compliant with other medicines, if there's any specific problems that need to be addressed, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah, now, I just want to observe something here. You and I are both talking, are both recognizing that glaucoma in the context of our practices is an important issue, and it deals with a large segment of our patient base. Neither one of us thinks of himself as a glaucoma specialist in terms of our clinical practice. I'm a comprehensive person with an anterior bias, you even more so. But I mean, this is a highly, highly relevant topic.
I think every ophthalmologist, if not every optometrist in the world, is the door to the diagnosis and the appropriate management of glaucoma. And I think there's millions of people walking out there with very high pressures. We have to think about glaucoma every time we use steroids, and we do it every day, many, many times a day. Unfortunately, there's systems internationally where patients can get their medications directly from a pharmacy. I think that it's not just a matter of the glaucoma specialist, but it's a matter of every ophthalmologist being very aware of these issues, because we like it, if we don't, we have a lot of glaucoma patients come in our practices.
Now, you are doing some interesting work from a diagnostic standpoint. Can I get you to talk about this, and specifically to talk about some of the work that you're doing with spectral domain OCT?
Sure. Of course, we're all familiar with the pros and cons of perimetry and automated perimetry. We know that it's a performance test, sort of, and it's quite difficult for the older population that we discussed before to be consistent, et cetera, et cetera. So objective measurements for glaucoma, going away from the traditional looking stereoscopically the optic nerve, have really caught up, and I think OCT really offers a great venue to objectively and in 3D picture the optic nerve. What I found very interesting with the OptiView has been a company that has pushed their proprietary software in evaluating also ganglion cell layers. I think ganglion cell layer, which is the actual tissue that it becomes damaged from glaucoma, may be a far more sensitive marker as far as obtaining maps of the retina with the health of the ganglion cell layer and being able to establish weakened ganglion cell layer or defective ganglion cell layer. We've been using it for the last 4 years. We find very good correlation with visual field defects, but I'm hoping that it may become a measure to catch glaucometer's changes before that, before we actually see them on visual field, because that's the goal, not to have our glaucoma patients reach that level, because once they reach that level, then we have to lower our intraocular pressure targets, et cetera, et cetera.
You know, that's a great point that you bring up, sensitivity. In that there are a lot of people saying now that visual field testing is really not the right way to follow people early on. That early on OCT testing is a much more sensitive way of following patients, because by the time that you get what is now called parametric disease, you know, when it's showing up on fields, there's been substantial tissue loss, and that we can follow this earlier with the sort of testing that you're talking about.
The only drawback of imaging the optic nerve, as we know from corneas, is that the optic nerve has to be looking at you. So nerves that are tilted or nerves that have optic nerve drusen or any irregularity around the nerve becomes challenging for these devices to scan, diagnose, and follow. So I think that's where ganglion cell layer may have a significant advantage, because it images a larger area of the retina. It can minimize the noise that all these anatomic particularities may bring into the picture from patient to patient. And we're hoping that by creating a larger database for normal, we'll be able to be far more sensitive in picking up abnormalities.
Now, in terms of management of these patients, you mentioned getting patients on drops with a schedule that's simpler. We talked about combination medications. There are procedures that can also make the patients less reliant on medications, or at the very least, perhaps, reduce the number of medications patients take. Can I get you to talk about that a little bit?
I think it's a very important area that's exploding in ophthalmology right now. Microincision glaucoma surgery definitely brings in a new era in addressing these patients. And it may be a significant era in addressing the patients early on when they're on one glaucoma drug, when they're maybe not that much scared about being compliant, and of course allowing them to live a more comfortable life without having to take glaucoma medications. I think that the jury is still out whether this will be a mainstay. There's a lot of new technology out there, contact lenses that may be releasing glaucoma medications, inserts of microbiodegradable or nanobiodegradable materials that may slowly release glaucoma medications. And we didn't talk, but I think another great area is neuroprotection. Finding neuroprotective agents that even if they cannot be used orally or in the form of drops, we may find a mode of delivery of these agents within the eye and work on the glaucoma damage side in the opposite way.
It's a wonderful field. It's very, very relevant to, I mean, obviously to the well-being of the patients' families. It's an intellectual field. You know, there's a lot going on, and there's a lot, as you say, that's going to be coming out in the very short term.
Absolutely, and it's very exciting. And I think that unfortunately, in our practice as ophthalmologists, glaucoma is probably one of the most challenging pathologies because it's chronic. We're used to intervening surgically and solving problems within 15 minutes, half hour. It is for the long term, and I think any new venue, any innovation is great, greatly appreciated.
Valuable stuff. John, I want to thank you once more for being so generous with your time with us today.
Thank you, Josh.